Welcome to the 15th meeting in 2024 of the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee. I'd like to remind everyone to please switch off or put to silent their mobile phones and other electronic devices. The first item of business is to decide whether to take items 6 and 7 in private. Is the committee content to take these items in private? On the agenda item number 2, we're considering instruments subject to the affirmative procedure. No points have been raised on the draft damages, review of rate of return, Scotland Regulations 2024, the draft National Health Service Scotland Act 1978, Independent Health Care Modification Order 2024, and the draft Healthcare Improvement Scotland Inspections Amendment Regulations 2024. Is the committee content with these instruments? Under agenda item number 3, we're considering an instrument subject to the negative procedure. No points have been raised on SSI 2024-130. Is the committee content with this instrument? Under agenda item number 4, we're considering an instrument not subject to any parliamentary procedure. No points have been raised on SSI 2024-131. Is the committee content with this instrument? Thank you. And with that, I'll suspend briefly. Moving to agenda item number 5, we are taking evidence on the Judicial Factors of Scotland Bill from Siobhan Brown, MSP, the Minister for Victims and Community Safety. The Minister is accompanied by two Scottish Government officials, Michael Paparakis, the Policy and Bill Programme Manager, and Megan Stefaniak, the Scottish Government Legal Directorate. I welcome you all to the meeting this morning and I'd like to remind you all to not to worry about turning on the microphones as they'll be done for you automatically. And before we move to questions, I invite the Minister to make some opening remarks.
Good morning, Committee. Apologies for my voice. The Judicial Factors Bill implements the Scottish Law Commission's recommendation on its 2013 report on judicial factors. If passed, it will put in place an updated and comprehensive regime which will bring clarity, accessibility and efficiency to this vital but outmoded area of law. Reform of the law of judicial factors is not, perhaps, particularly high profile, but the bill will make important and practical changes for those who are involved with judicial factors in one way or another. A judicial factor is a person appointed by the court to gather, hold, safeguard, and administer property which is not being properly managed. Common examples include where there has been a breach of the Law Society accounting rules, or where a sole practitioner dies or there is no executor willing to carry out the administration of an estate. But there are also circumstances where we know that a judicial factor could usefully be appointed, but they aren't for a number of reasons, such as in the cases where the estate of a missing person needs to be managed. The overall modernisation of the office should make the appointment of a judicial factor more suitable in cases involving missing persons. And I understand, however, the complexities and the difficulties that come with dealing with a loved one's estate in these circumstances. And that is why I've agreed to work with the charity Missing People to prepare guidance for those who are considering applying to appoint a judicial factor. The SLC recommend that some of the provisions in the bill should extend to the whole of the United Kingdom, and my officials have started the process of engaging with the UK government about pursuing a Section 104 order. This would include provisions so that the judicial factor is able to exercise their functions in relation to the whole of the estate, regardless of where in the United Kingdom the property is situated. It would also include provisions around a judicial factor's powers to obtain information from UK bodies and UK government departments. The Law Society of Scotland has raised the problem of how the Solicitors Scotland Act 1980 operates when it comes to incorporated practices, and has asked for the 1980 Act to be amended to extend the existing intervention powers in relation to sole practitioners to incorporated practices. Amendments have been lodged to the Regulation of Legal Services Bill, and that will address these concerns. Convener, the bill will introduce a statutory framework which sets out clearly the essential features of the office or judicial factor and the broad parameters within which it should operate and will be to the benefit of all those involved in any capacity in judicial factories. I know that there are a number of areas of detail that have come up in stage one evidence sessions, and I've worked with the committee and on MSPs on another SLC bill already this session in order to address these issues identified, and I will continue to do so as this bill progresses through Parliament. And I look forward to answering your committee's questions.
Minister, thank you very much for your opening comments. Certainly some of the areas that you covered we will be asking questions on this morning. So the first one is regarding the missing people. Now, as you're aware, the committee has taken evidence from missing people and also the Law Society, and they have said that the bill could have done more to address the needs of families when people go missing. And the Scottish Law Commission has said to the committee that it thinks the solution is not changes to the legislation, but good advertising and guidance on the bill, as well as a court procedure that is accessible to the layperson. And having heard all the evidence, and you did touch upon this with your comments regarding the, working with missing people to have guidance, but do you think that there actually should be an explicit reference on the face of the bill to it being possible to appoint a factor to a missing person's estate? And to what extent do you think that any policy concerns here can be resolved purely by advertising and guidance on the legislation in the context of missing people?
Yes, thank you, Convener. I think on the face of the bill, it doesn't need a particular statement for missing persons as such, because obviously we want judicial factors to cover all aspects, not just one specific action. But as I said in my opening speech, I am working with Missing People's Charity to look at how we can strengthen the guidance for people in that situation.
Certainly the missing people, when they gave evidence to the committee, they were quite explicit that to have a reference on the face of the bill would certainly assist. I think they were supportive of guidance, a strengthening of guidance as well, but they were clear that they did want a specific reference on the face of the bill. And their argument wasn't about only highlighting one group of individuals, but it was an attempt to highlight a group of individuals that are very much at the margins. To try to assist, because I mean every single case will be very different.
Yes, and I appreciate that, and we will continue to work with them, and I'm open to working in the future that if there's anything that we can bring in to give some comfort to that charity in particular, we'll consider it.
Thank you. And missing people also, before when they came in front of the committee, they highlighted a number of purposes, and they raised an interesting issue about the purpose of a judicial factor appointment in the context of an estate of a missing person. That pointed out that when a missing person might have wished, so what a missing person might have wished done with their estate, i.e., for example, a support for elderly relatives, it might not always coincide with what is in the best interests of the estate, such as a conservation of funds. Can you provide any further clarification over which approaches a judicial factor can take if there is any such conflict, And is there a need for a specific legislative statement in the context of missing people?
Thank you, Convener. Section 10 of the Bill is clear that judicial factors have to hold, manage, administer and protect the estate for the benefit of the persons with an interest in the estate. And I consider that in most of the judicial factors will be expected to manage the estate in the interest of the missing person. What considerations a judicial factor will take into account when making decisions, for example, whether they can take into account assumed preferences of the missing person, will depend on the purpose of the appointment and the specific circumstances of each individual case. The bill is flexible, and the person seeking appointment of a judicial factor can ask for additional powers to be conferred on the judicial factor, such as the power to make gifts. And it would be possible for a judicial factor to manage the estate in the interests of the missing person and make payments to or take actions to benefit family members or of the missing person, such as their children, for example.
Okay, no, thank you. I'm going to hand over to Tim Eagle. Tim.
Good morning, Minister. And thank you for coming in. The Charity Law Association, when they were here, made a few comments around the fact that they didn't think the law as it is currently is really helped in the case of charities, and they wanted new provisions put in that would specifically help with that. The Commission, however, when they came in, said rather than new, potentially you could amend. Do you have any thoughts and feelings around that, or how we could potentially help with the Charity Law Association?
Yes, sure. I understand that there have been some concerns have been raised about the interaction between the bill and the charities legislation, which I am taking away to consider at the moment. The bill is concerned with the general approach to appointments of the judicial factors. A judicial factor can also be appointed under the more specific legislation, and when this is provided for, such as under the charities legislation, and the bill does not change that. The requirements under the bill exist alongside any requirements in other areas of law, such as charities law, trust law, or company law. Depending on the particular circumstances of the case, and a judicial factor might be required to comply with the relevant requirements in such areas. Section 10 of the bill also makes it clear that the functions of a judicial factor under the bill are subject to provision in other legislation, and the SLC has suggested some specific areas of possible amendments, and I think it's important that we take time to explore these and other interested stakeholders further, including OSCA. So I will write to the committee ahead of stage one debate, setting out my thoughts on this matter.
Perfect. Thank you. Yeah. Thank you. And just in your opening statement, Minister, you touched upon the Section 104 process. I think, and you indicated that I think discussions are already underway with that. And as you're very much aware, it's been a recurring theme in any of the SLC bills that this committee has looked at in this session. Can you clarify that if the Scottish Government actually want the information gathering powers to extend to private sector bodies based elsewhere in the UK, such as banks and building societies, etc.?
Yes, sure, Convener, thank you. So we're at the early stages of the process, and so the exact drafting approach has not yet been agreed. However, the aim is to ensure that a judicial factor appointed on an estate is able to exercise their functions in relation to the whole of the estate, regardless of where in the United Kingdom the property is situated, and ensuring that the relevant property is appropriately managed. As such, it is intended that the Section 104 order will extend some of the provisions in the bill to the whole of the United Kingdom, and this includes provisions as to vesting of property in a judicial factor, in gathering of property, judicial factors functions, and also information sharing provisions. So the intention is also to explore the application of the requirement to comply with the information requests to the bodies excluded under the bill, such as the UK government departments or bodies with other reserved functions. Officials have made initial contact with relevant UK government departments about seeking a Section 104 order, and these discussions thus far have been positive, and the work will continue with to have these discussions as the bill progresses.
Okay, no, thank you. Has there been any dialogue between yourself and the Secretary of State for Scotland on the issue of a Section 104 order?
Not at this stage, no.
Okay. No. In terms of the 104 order, would you consider that would apply to sections 12 and 39 of the bill across the UK? And if so, in what timescale would you anticipate?
Yes, we would be including those, and we are looking. I think the average timescale at the moment for the section 104 has been 12 to 18 months.
Okay. I think it would be useful if you could keep the committee kind of updated on any progress with that, please.
Of course.
No, thank you. Thanks. Oliver?
Hey, thank you, convener. I wanted to ask the Law Society and Accountant of Court. I have both expressed concerns about subsections of subsections 12 and 39 of the bill, which restate the current legal position in relation to data protection legislation, making it clear that these sections do not authorise anything which would breach this. Various stakeholders have highlighted to the committee that legitimate information requests, especially by judicial factors, can already be denied or delayed. This is due to unjustified reliance on data protection legislation, coupled with a failure to fully understand the judicial factors' role. Does the Minister see any validity in these policy concerns? And if the bill is to cross-refer to data protection legislation, do its legitimate uses need to be examined in more detail, either on the face of the bill or associated guidance?
Thank you. I thank Mr. Mundell for that question. The powers under Section 12 and 39 operate within the framework and are consistent with data protection legislation. Sections 12.7 and 39.6 simply clarify, for the avoidance of doubt, that these provisions are not intended to override data protection legislation. Provisions making clear data protection is not overridden are not unusual. For example, Section 12 of the Redress for the Survivors, the Historical Child Abuse in Care Scotland Act 2021, or Paragraph 24 of Schedule 1 of the Elections Act 2022 make similar provisions. So it is considered that such provisions can be useful in clarifying the interplay with data protection legislation. As we know, data protection legislation is a reserved matter, and there is information on the Information Commissioner's website as well if people are seeking it. So at this stage, we wouldn't think that there would be need anything on the face of the bill regarding that.
I thought it was currently on the face of the bill, and it's just whether it would be better moved into guidance.
Yeah,
because it's currently on Man
Sides. Yes, sorry.
That kind of draws more attention to it than the Law Society felt was justified, mm-hmm. given that it is already the law and applies to everything. Sort of the specific mention of it almost over highlighted it, and they felt that people who didn't really understand what a judicial factor was might then use that as a kind of default reason. Kind of not to engage.
So I think what I might do is I might bring in Michael, who's got the history on this. But my understanding was it wasn't thought necessary due to all the, even if the legislation, data protection is updated, it will always be updated by the UK government on the Information Commissioner, so it will keep in step with things. Michael, did you want to add anything?
I mean, the explanatory notes to the bill could be used as a means to try and clarify some of the interplay or the concerns addressed by the Faculty of Advocates, I think it was you said. So that could be one way to try and address the concerns. And obviously, as the Minister has said, in terms of missing persons, the guidance there, that could be an issue addressed in guidance as well.
I think it was the Law Society and a lady who has been there for a very long time, who's their in-house judicial factor as well. So she's got a lot of experience of working in this legislation. She said, you know, it's not something most people know about. You know, they hear judicial factor, that, you know, they're not clear on what that is. They don't understand that the person, you know, who's appointed as the judicial factor is effectively acting as the person themselves. And therefore there's already confusion. And by putting this reference to the Data Protection Act onto the face of the bill, you know, she was concerned that people would kind of default to that, you know, as a reason not to provide information. And it's just whether you would consider moving it either into guidance or into the explanatory notes, you know, rather than it getting such a prominent, you know, that piece of legislation getting such a prominent reference at that point in the bill.
I'm happy to take that away and give that a consideration.
Yeah. Thank you. I know it's a bit of a strange one because I always feel data protection is so important.
Yeah.
But I mean, the evidence we heard was quite compelling that people who are not familiar with this legislation, who are interacting with for the first time, or who are wise, you know, it just kind of seemed over the top in this case.
Okay, thank you. And Bill Kidd.
Thank you very much, convener. pardon me, there's going to be a bit of, I think, you're okay. It's going to be a wee bit, as we all know, of toing and froing in some of these sections here because they do cross over each other quite a wee bit. But in section four, qualifications for appointment as a judicial factor, when the Commission appeared before us on the 16th of April, it commented that it thought that the court was best placed to decide who was suitable for the role. And it highlighted, for example, that in the case of a farming business where two farmers fell out, the person best placed to be appointed as a factor was another farmer, just for the inside knowledge. Well, the qualifications required to be a judicial factor on that basis, with the main qualification being that the court decides this person most suitable for the role. The Scottish Law Commission and others, including the Law Society and Missing People, have said that the court is best placed to decide who is suitable in individual cases. Property Mark, on the other hand, wants the bill to be more prescriptive in its requirements, including by specifying certain professional qualifications. Now, having considered all of the views expressed to the committee during stage one scrutiny, which policy decision out of those does the Minister prefer? And if you support any changes to section four, can you give us an idea of those, please?
Thank you, Mr. Kidd. I don't consider at this stage that it's necessary for a person to be appointed as a judicial factor to hold a professional qualification. The bill takes a flexible approach to who it may be appointed to ensure that it can cater to a wide range of circumstances, and discretion is given to the court to decide whether the person in question is a suitable person to hold the office in particular circumstances of the case. Reading the bill as a whole, it is clear that there are safeguards in place. For example, judicial factors are supervised by the accountant of court and they are under duty to obtain specialist advice where appropriate. And most judicial factors appointed are either legal or financial professionals, but there may be some circumstances where that's not necessary or even desirable. And I think you mentioned about our farming and an agricultural expert per se. So I think to require a judicial factor to hold a professional qualification would also add unnecessary costs to the administration of the estate. And I agree with what the Faculty of Advocates said, that we should trust the discretion of the court to take into account the circumstances of the individual case and appoint the most suitable person as a judicial factor.
Okay, well, thank you for that. Now, just on the back of that, when the Faculty of Advocates gave evidence to us on the 23rd of April, it supported the current approach to appointments. and when your judicial factor is appointed by the court in relation to a solicitor or a firm of solicitors under the Solicitor Scotland Act 1980, it's typically the Law Society's in-house judicial factor who is appointed. The Faculty of Procurators, however, of Caithness has suggested that the current system doesn't work and the judicial factor in these types of cases should always be wholly independent of the Law Society. Of course, the Law Society, Law Commission and the Faculty of Advocates expressed their support for the present system in opposition to that. Having considered all the submissions put to the government, put to the committee on this issue, what policy position did the Scottish Government prefer, and would you consider a specific statement for in Section 4 of the bill for the use of society's in-house factor?
Thank you, Mr. Kidd. I consider this is a matter for the Law Society and persons involved in an application for an appointment. I can see the benefit of the Law Society having a knowledgeable in-house factor when considerable practical experience and how this might help and also protect clients. The bill provides a way of persons opposed to the appointment of an in-house factor to make their views known. For instance, this could be done at the stage where The court is being asked to appoint a factor, and any objections to be made to the court, who will have to make that decision. If there are any concerns about the actings or the in-house factor about appointment, then these can be brought to the attention of the accountant or to the Law Society. I don't know, Michael or Megan, if you want to add anything further to that.
Not much more to add. As the Minister said, ultimately, if the Law Society decide that the in-house factor should be appointed, then the application process itself presents an opportunity for objections to be made. If they think that, you know, someone independent of the Law Society should be appointed, and during the subsistence of the judicial factory, if there are any doubts or any questions about the actings of the judicial factor, then those can be brought to the attention of the accountant, who is under a duty to investigate those as well.
Thank you. Here's a question. A question on financial eligibility criteria and how they're applied as a policy choice between those whose finances would be assessed and the person applying to be the judicial factor. In section 4 of the bill, missing people's main policy concern is a practical one, and that is what an application will cost and whether families will be able to afford this. Can the Minister offer families of people who go missing in Scotland assurances about the potential availability of legal aid, and will financial eligibility criteria be applied in terms of legal aid applications, whose resources would be assessed, and those of the applicant of those those of the applicant or those of the missing person? That makes sense.
Yes, thank you for that. First of all, it would be on the applicant, not on the missing person. And second, the applicant would be able to get legal aid for advice and guidance initially with the solicitor to sort of work out whether they should go for a judicial factor or not, if it would be relevant for them. If a person is on benefits, then they would have their court fees paid by legal aid, but the assessment would be on the applicant.
On the applicant, right. Yeah. But that legal aid is available for people in those circumstances then, yes?
There is, yes. Right. Initially, everybody should get legal aid for advice from the solicitor.
Okay. Staying on section 4 of the bill, when someone is applying to be a judicial factor, the accountant of court told us that she thought there were other checks that she could potentially do on an applicant's suitability, and this might include checking the applicant's credit status and checking whether they had been made bankrupt at any time. She said the applicant could also be required to flag if their financial circumstances change after they've been appointed. Did the Scottish Government give any consideration to putting these additional types of checks and safeguards on the face of the bill? And what do you think and regard as the potential advantages or disadvantages of including these types of requirements, please?
Thank you. So the process for appointment is such that the accountant is not involved at the initial stages of an application, and this is for a matter for the court alone. It would be open to the court to make such inquiries as it considers appropriate to assist it in deciding whether the person seeking appointment is suitable, and that this might include whether they are currently bankrupt. The accountant acts as a supervisor to factory estates, and I think that such checks might be helpful in making sure that this function is carried out appropriately. And it seems that the accountant already carries these out, so I don't think that anything further is needed.
But you're aware of these concerns?
Yes.
That have been raised anyway? And
yes.
You've had a look at them, so basically.
Yes, my officials haven't, yes.
Right, well, thank you very much for that.
Thank you.
Thank you. And Faisal Chowdhury.
Thank you, Convener. Welcome, Minister. Under the current law, judicial factor must find cation. That is to take out a specialist bond from an insurance company to protect against wrongdoing by the factor, such as theft of the estate. Section 5 of the bill in a policy change to the current law abolishes the requirement on a judicial factor to find cation, save in exceptional circumstance. When proposing this new threshold, what investigations did the Scottish Government do on professional indemnity insurance as a suitable alternative to bonds of cation, or indeed on the other possible alternatives to bond of cation?
Thank you, Mr. Chowdhury. And if I may, I might give hands over to Michael because he has a technical history on that to answer that question, if that's all right.
Yeah, so the Scottish Government didn't look at the specific issue of indemnity insurance, but the concern, as I understand it, was raised by the Law Society during the Commission's consultation. So the SLC considered this matter and decided to proceed as done in the bill with the recommendations. In terms of checks for indemnity insurance, whether that covers the actings of the judicial factor, the court would be able to make those kinds of investigations. So if there's any question or any doubt, the court can ask the person applying or the judicial factor to be appointed. They can ask whether the indemnity insurance does cover it. If it doesn't, then the court would have the option of ordering cation or some other form of something similar as a consignation of money or some other type of similar cation.
Thank you. My next question is, the committee has heard evidences from several legal stakeholders that the proposed threshold, exceptional circumstance, may be set too high. It might not result in cation being recurred where a layperson is being appointed, and that for professionals, their specific professional indemnity insurance might not be an adequate substitute. On the other hand, missing people in concerned about the cost of cation and prefers that existing threshold. Having heard all the views expressed the committee on this issue, is the minister still convinced that exceptional circumstance is the right threshold? If not, what policy alternatives would you propose and why?
Okay, thank you. I don't consider the test to be too high. I believe it strikes a right balance between protecting the estate from the improper actings of a judicial factor and unnecessary costs. Evidence has indicated that bonds of cation can be very difficult to obtain and can cost thousands of pounds each year, which is paid from the estate. And this could be prohibitive in circumstances where, for example, a family member is appointed to administer the estate of a missing person, or else completely unnecessary where indemnity insurance covers the judicial factor's actings. Most judicial factors are currently professionals with indemnity insurance, and the committee has heard that this can cover their actings as a judicial factor. If a non-professional judicial factor is appointed, then the court will have the discretion to order cation, and there are safeguards in the bill in relation to this. These include the fact that all judicial factors are supervised by the accountant, and then they must submit an inventory of the estate property and a management plan, as well as regular accounts for audit. Any person who has concerns about a judicial factor can complain to the accountant, who is required to investigate and has the power to direct a judicial factor to do so or not to do so, do something. So the accountant must also report serious misconduct to the court.
Thank you. And Tim Eagle.
Yes, so up until about a month ago, Minister, I didn't know what the Register of Inhibitions was, but I do now, and we've been having quite the debate on whether that's the correct place to put the appointment of judicial factors. So various of the people that have been in front of us have debated that. Most would agree that that's maybe not 100% the right place, but there was some concern over the cost of setting up a completely new location for that. There was also concern about the searchable nature for the public of the Register of Inhibitions. Have you got any thoughts yourself, having listened to that evidence, as to whether that you still think that's the right place to put that?
Yes, so currently only some kinds of appointment of the judicial factors need to be publicised, and most respondents to the CLC's consultation were of the view that some form of publication of appointments was necessary, and the SLC did consult with the Keeper of the Registers of Scotland and concluded that a registration in the Register of Inhibitions was inappropriate. I don't know, Michael, if you wanted to add anything to that.
Yeah, I mean, I think it ultimately comes to the benefits and the disadvantages of a new register versus the current register. I think it was the Law Society that suggested that the Register of Inhibitions was a compromise. Ultimately, the Register of Inhibitions is there to prevent someone acting, or you know, for instance, taking out a loan on property that a judicial factor may be appointed on. And we think that in terms of current practice, people would normally search the Register of Inhibitions for that type of case. And so that's why the Register of Inhibitions was chosen. The evidence from the accountant, I think it was last week, about the possibility of a new register, while they said it was possible, they did also suggest a figure. Although I understand they were going to give you potentially write to you with something a bit more considered. But I think that the figure they had suggested just off the cuff maybe gives you an idea of the costs. And there is also the potential issue of people perhaps not searching that register on a regular basis, so that the appointment of a judicial factor over property is missed, which is obviously counter to the actual policy that we want to take forward here in the bill.
So just for clarity there then, because yeah, the concern with the Register of Inhibitions is that it's not easily searchable by the public, but you are content that that is the most cost-effective way of recording the appointment of judicial factors, and that there is support in place that should a member of the public want to search that they will be able to do that?
Yes. Uh-huh. Yes. The Register runs their own website on the Register of Inhibitions about costs. I think the professional, if you have a business registration, the costs are about £1 a search. Okay. And you know, if an individual was perhaps going to, you know, offer a loan on property or buy property, they would go through a solicitor. So that solicitor would then obviously search the register on their behalf. If it was an individual and they were just doing it themselves, I understand the cost is about £30 for a search, which may or may not be expensive, depending on your point of view.
Okay. Okay, fine. Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Right.
Sorry. Can I ask for two minutes just to go out?
Sure, no problem.
Thank you.
No problem. We'll suspend briefly. Any further questions, Mr. Eagle?
No, actually, I think that explains it, actually. So I think there was quite a lot of discussion around that, but I think that makes sense to me, yeah.
Okay, thank you. And Alderman Dell.
Section 17 of the bill covers the investment power of a judicial factor in respect to the estate. In respect of Section 17, does the Minister agree with certain stakeholders that it should be on the face of the legislation that a judicial factor could choose to invest in ethical, social or governance-tested ESG investments, even if this might not lead to a maximum income for the estate? And can you explain your reasoning here for the benefit of the committee?
Yes, of course. Thank you, Mr. Mundell, for the question. I think there's been some confusion about what the Trust and Succession Scotland Act 2024 allows in this area. To clarify, if there's no contrary intention in the trust deed, then the 2024 Act allows trustees to properly take non-financial considerations into account when choosing between investments for that trust. This, however, is only in situations where, for example, the environmentally friendly investment has the best financial prospects or has financial prospects that are equally as good as those of another investment. In other words, trustees are not always bound to maximise financial returns where a suitable investment would be consistent with the purposes of the trust or where they have taken proper advice. Rather, the investment policy that trustees adopt should reflect the purposes of the trust. The questions put to stakeholders by the committee has asked whether judicial factors should have a power to invest in lower performing investments if they meet specified ESG criteria. This is different to the provision in the Trust and Succession Act, and I do not agree that there is a need to expressly confer such a power on a judicial factor. Not all judicial factors will need to take to make investment decisions, and the bill requires judicial factors to consider whether it would be appropriate to invest, and this is not likely to be the case for all judicial factories. The bill is not prescriptive as how to invest, and it leaves it up to the judicial factor to decide this, taking professional advice where appropriate. I am, however, willing to look into this matter further and have asked my officials to write to stakeholders in the coming months asking for their views on whether an express power similar to those available in trustees would be welcome. And I'm happy to write to the committee ahead of stage one on my thoughts on that.
That's helpful. I guess it kind of also ties in to a certain amount with some of the questions around missing persons as well.
Yep.
You know, and just where within this legislation non-financial criteria kind of fit. And there's overlap in the kind of charity sections, there's potential of people being a judicial factor for a trust. You know, I think just more generally just understanding exactly where as we go into stage two, just exactly how because I think we're modernising a very old legislation, and I think through the evidence we've heard in various areas, there are points when financial return is not the kind of sole or holding things static exactly as they are today is not the kind of sole consideration that that people would expect, and it's just is judicial factor are we going to change the role of the judicial factor slightly as part of this?
That's what we'll go out and we'll talk to stakeholders, and then I'll get back to you regarding that. But I appreciate your points on the matter.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. And Tim Eagle.
Thank you. So you can maybe educate me on how to pronounce this correctly, but the fiduciary nature, there we go, the nature of the judicial factor's duties, there was a discussion around whether they need to be explicitly laid out within the bill. I think some were sort of arguing that it didn't. The context was self-evident within the bill. Others were saying, actually, no, you could have a much bigger... much bigger layout of effectively what those duties are. What is the Scottish Government's view on this, and would you be open to amending the bill if you thought that was something that was worth doing?
Thank you, Mr. Eagles. Reading the bill as a whole, I think it's clear that the nature of the judicial factor's role is fiduciary. While the term fiduciary duty is not used in the bill, it considered that the bill achieves the same effect. Fiduciary duty is essentially a duty to act in good faith in the interest of another rather than in your own self-interest. And Section 10 of the bill makes it clear that judicial factors have to hold, manage and administer and protect the factory estate for the benefit of the persons with an interest in the estate. It also requires judicial factors to exercise care, prudence and diligence and take professional advice when appropriate. The Scottish Law Commission told the committee that it was very clearly set out in its report that the essence of the institution was that it was a fiduciary and that it was not considered necessary to include a specific reference to this in the bill. I understand that some of the stakeholders have suggested that this matter should be clarified, but others such as the SLC and the Faculty of Advocates have pointed out that to add even a simple statement to that effect could have unintended consequences. I do, however, think that it might be possible to add something into the explanatory notes to make this point clearer for the users of the legislation, and I'm willing to consider that further.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. Yeah, it's Mr. Dugal again.
Which one am I on now? 15.
15.
Yeah. Sorry. Yep. The Faculty of Advocates, with support from the Centre of Scots Law, has said to the committee that it would be useful to give the judicial factor an additional power in Part 2 of the bill to seek direction from the court. Other stakeholders' views, however, on that have been more mixed, with some suggestion that the court already has the powers it needs within the bill. Having heard all the views expressed to the committee, what is your position on this, and would you be open to amending the bill in such a way as the Faculty of Advocates suggest?
Sure, thank you. I consider that an additional power allowing judicial factors to seek directions from the court is not necessary given the nature of the office and the fact that there are other options available. Judicial factors accept office on the understanding that they are there to use their judgment, take professional advice where appropriate, and make decisions in relation to the estate. If they have any doubts as to whether they have the necessary powers to take a particular course of action, they can apply to the court for additional powers under Section 11 of the bill, and this can be done at any time after the initial appointment. While the court directions might be useful in trust estates and executories, this is because there's no equivalent to the accountant. The only option is to go to court. So judicial factors, on the other hand, are supervised by the accountant, and if unsure about what they should or can do, then they should consult the accountant and agree on a way forward. As such, I don't think we need to add another route for directions, particularly as this would add significant cost to the factory estate. Seeking directions of the court comes with court fees and, of course, legal expenses. But before the committee reaches any conclusion on this issue, I would urge you to seek the views of the Lord President on his views on this issue.
Okay, thank you. That's helpful, actually.
Okay.
Thank you. And Faisal Chowdhury.
Thank you, Minister. Section 23 of the bill sets out the general rule that if a judicial factor is involved in court proceedings on behalf of the state, any legal cost associated with this will come out of the state. The Faculty of Advocates and Sheriffs and Summary Sheriffs Association have both said that Section 23 of the bill could be modified. This would be to deal with exceptional circumstances when a judicial factor had acted unreasonably in a situation not covered by Section 24 and so should be found personally liable for legal cost. The Commission and the Law Society, on the other hand, were not certain that this suggested modification was the right approach. The Commission, for example, feared that judicial factor would become unduly preoccupied with their risk of personal liabilities. Having heard all the views expressed to the committee, what is the Scottish Government's position on this issue? Would the Minister be open to amending Section 23 of the bill in the way suggested Can you explain the reasons underpinning your views?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Section 23 of the bill contains a general rule that costs of litigation pursued by the judicial factor on behalf of the factory estate are to be met from the factory estate. The general rule is, however, subject to Section 24 of the bill. Under Section 24, the court is given a power to find a judicial factor personally liable if they have breached their duty and the court finds it appropriate to hold them personally liable. We need to strike the right balance to allow a judicial factor a reasonable space to manage an estate in good faith. And I don't think that a judicial factor should be found personally liable if, with the benefit of hindsight, their actions are found to have been unreasonable, but where there has been no breach of duty. Given the continuing need for competent judicial factors, we must be careful and we don't unnecessarily want to put blocks in the way of people wanting to be appointed. And allowing for judicial factors to be held personally liable for taking actions which do not amount to a breach of duty would, in my view, likely discourage judicial factors from pursuing litigation, that it is in the interest of the estate and perhaps even discourage individuals from acting as a judicial factor altogether.
Thank you. In relation to part four of the bill, missing people have expressed concern about what it sees as lack of clarity associated with the interaction between the presumption of death, Scotland Act 1977, and part four of the bill. Does the minister think the interrelationship between the two pieces of the legislation needs to be clarified, either on the face of the bill or in associated guidance?
Thank you. I consider that the bill and the 1977 Act work alongside each other. The bill allows for the appointment of a judicial factor to manage the estate of a missing person, and if the missing person is subsequently declared dead by the way of an application under the 1977 Act, the purpose for which the judicial factor was appointed would no longer exist and the judicial factor would be terminated. As the committee heard, families of missing people may not want to immediately apply for a declarator and appointment of the judicial factor to manage the missing person's estate is an alternative as well.
Thank you. Staying on the missing people. Missing people have raised another issues with part four, especially what the procedures would be if the missing person came back and the judicial factory was still ongoing. Can the minister confirm whether, under the bill, termination of judicial factory would be automatic in those circumstances or would instead, as the committee suspect, require a court approval? What is the policy rationale for the approach of the Scottish Government has taken here?
Thank you. A judicial factor is a person appointed by the court, and I consider there must be a formal process for bringing the office to an end. This would protect both the missing person who has returned and the judicial factor who may be a family member. It is important that the missing person can take over the management of their estate as quickly as possible, but it's also important that the actings of the judicial factor can be scrutinised and that they can be discharged of liability. The bill provides an administrative process overseen by the accountant for the termination of the judicial factory. In most cases, this is what would be used. Alternatively, the bill also provides persons with an interest with a route to apply to the court for distribution of the factory estate.
Do you think it is necessary to define, either in legislation or guidance,
the missing persons as say, and I think that came up in a previous, at this moment, no, but we're happy to consider it.
Thank you. Thanks, and Bill Kidd.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you very much for the replies we've been getting. I'm sure they'll be extremely helpful. There is a relationship between discharge and investigations. in terms of sections 34 and 38 of the bill. Now, the committee has been considering the interrelationship of these two sections, 34 and 38. And 34 of section 34 says the discharge usually ends a factor's liability, and section 38 of the bill covers the investigatory powers of the accountant and the court. So can the minister confirm what the position is if a factor is discharged under section 34, but then misconduct subsequently comes to light? And what is the policy justification for the approach that would be taken in this instance?
Thank you. So section 34 of the bill and the accompanying explanatory notes are clear that the effect of the discharge is that the judicial factor is no longer accountable for what has taken place during the course of the judicial factory. And as such, once a judicial factor is discharged, the accountant would not be able to investigate or report any misconduct under section 38. The SLC report is clear that once the factor leaves office, this should end, and any obligation to account further to the estate or those representing it. To do otherwise runs the real risk of discouraging individuals from taking on the role, which was a point that the accountant made in her evidence session last week. And importantly, there are safeguards in place. Judicial factors are supervised by the accountant and required to regularly submit the accounts and report to her on the management of the estate. And before a judicial factor can be discharged, the accountant has to audit the final accounts and be satisfied that everything's in order. Further, section 34 makes absolutely clear that discharge has no effect on criminal liability. Both criminal liability and any civil liability connected to it continue after the discharge, which means that a judicial factor can still be held accountable for it. For example, if they've committed fraud in the course of the judicial factory.
Okay, thank you. Now, this is it can be complex to people who don't have much training, if any. So what do you make of the view that the interrelationship between these two provisions, 34 and 38, needs to be explained more clearly on the face of the bill for everyone's benefit?
Okay, thank you. I might bring in Michael, if I can, for this question.
I think our position is it is clear how the two work, as the Minister set out. Section 34 is about the accountant's power to investigate, which would obviously end upon the discharge of the factor. Obviously, the explanatory notes are a vehicle by which we could try and make it clearer, as obviously there have been some concerns raised by stakeholders, so that could be a potential way to clarify the situation. Equally, I think it would be important to note that although the accountant isn't able to investigate after a factor's discharge, it doesn't stop other people. So persons with an interest in the estate, for instance, you know, they could potentially raise an action in court to try and recover the funds, any funds that have, you know, attached to any criminal liability as well.
Okay, well, that's perfectly reasonable. But you did mention there that in terms of the explanatory notes, they could maybe be strengthened, actually, to give people a clearer idea, in particular those who are very concerned about the outcomes that may come in their own particular cases. And could that be looked into, do you think?
I'm happy to take that away and we'll definitely consider that.
Thank you very much for that. Thank you.
Thank you. And Oliver Mundell.
Thank you, Convener. In response to the committee's call for views, the Law Society said that the bill as introduced contains a significant departure from the Commission's draft bill. Specifically, the Law Society considers that there has been a watering down of the levels of legal and accountancy knowledge required for the roles of accountant and the deputy accountant. And we then heard from SCTS, on the other hand, that the bill reflects the existing approach and that the existing approach works well, with the same person who's the accountant of court also serving as a public guardian, and therefore it's important to think about the person's suitability in the context of both roles, particularly taking into account that the public guardian's work, you know, takes up the majority of the of the time. Having heard all the evidence, does the Scottish Government agree with STCS, or are you sort of minded to look again at this?
Thank you. I don't agree that the bill lowers the criteria required for a person to be appointed as the accountant. While the drafting of the SLC provision has been updated, there was no intention to depart from the recommendation in the SLC report. The recommendation was that the accountant should have the knowledge of laws and accounts, with the report also providing that this does not necessarily mean that they should be required to be formally qualified in both or either. And the bill provides that the accountant must be appropriately qualified or experienced in law or accounting. This is not, in my mind, a watering down of standards, and I consider that the bill gives effect to the SLC recommendation. I heard last week what Patrick Layden had to say to the committee regarding the issue, and this was raised with him in correspondence after that session. Mr. Layden confirmed to me that the drafting of the bill is consistent with the SLC's policy recommendations. Under the bill, the SCTS will determine whether the person appointed is the best fit for the role, and I think this sees a sensible approach to take, particularly given the accountant is their employee. The SCTS have had the power to appoint an accountant for around 90 years, and I'm not aware of any concerns that has been raised about who they've appointed over that time or their experience or their knowledge.
No, that's helpful. I mean, I guess, just taking it a stage further, I mean, if you were a member, because I think that's one of the concerns, is the bill's potentially going to widen out the number of people using using judicial factors or engaging with it. I mean, I think if you heard that someone was, what was an accountant, would you expect that they had an accountancy, some form of accountancy qualification behind that? So.
Yes, I think it would be up to each judicial factor on each case's merit for who would be the judicial factor in it.
But as in, you'd think the account. I'm saying if you heard someone was an accountant at court, mm-hmm. you're kind of. If you weren't familiar with all these other pieces of legislation,
you would think that they were an accountant, per se.
I
think you raise a valid point, because a general layperson would probably assume they were an accountant, so maybe there's something that we could look at to sort of make that clearer.
Yeah. Okay. Because I think it's just, and it's also, I mean, the balance of skills within the, within the kind of team, and I know that's then becomes an operational matter, yeah. But I think.
Mr. Mundell, can I just bring Michael in, because he will have a lot of the history about the technical aspects of that.
I mean, I think with the in terms of the accountant, you obviously heard from her last week that their view that there doesn't need to be a professional qualification, that they have considerable experience in the role, and as the minister has pointed out, the SCTS have had the power to appoint the accountant for nearly 90 years, and there's been no questions raised. About the qualifications. The accountant does have the ability to buy in professional experience, so they can obtain legal opinions, or they can obtain expert views from an accountant if needed to. But as we understand from our discussions with the accountant of court, largely their role being supervisor doesn't require them to be a qualified either a legal qualification or an accountancy qualification, because their role is supervision, it's administrative, it's about giving advice. So to require an accountancy qualification or a legal qualification, it may mean that the person is overqualified for the role, the qualification is not being used in the way that it perhaps would otherwise.
I hear that, and it's all helpful. The one thing I'd push back, and I'm cautious, you're official as opposed to the minister, but we have had the question posed. It's not, I know there's been maybe not been any practical examples, but we are currently having the question around the level of qualification posed by the Law Society. So it's a sort of relatively significant stakeholder. So it's not, the question's not coming from me, and it's mm-hmm. not, in that sense, not. It's not unfounded. It's
absolutely. We will take that away and consider.
That's why I wanted to just push it a wee bit further.
Yeah, no, that's fine. Thank you.
Thank you. And Tim Eagle.
Yep, just a couple of relatively specific questions actually around section 38.4 of the bill. So the first one is around where the accountant must refer a judicial factor to their professional body. And the question is, in the terms of solicitors, can you just confirm for the clarity for the committee that that is to the Scottish Legal Complaints Commission and, or the Law Society?
So, thank you. I don't see any difficulties with the report on serious misconduct by a solicitor acting as a judicial factor being sent to the Law Society, because my understanding, if there wasn't a complaint, it would be sent to the Law Society in the first instant, and then it would be sent to the SLCC. The Law Society advised my officials that if the accountant were to report serious misconduct by a solicitor under the bill, then they would pass this on to the SLC just as a matter of practice, and there's nothing in the bill that would prevent the accountant from sending a copy of the report to the SLC as well. I will, though, consider this matter further to see whether what would happen in practice can be more accurately reflected within the bill.
That's good then, because I think there was a concern that the SLCC should be the first port of call, but if you've spoken to them and they've said actually Law Society and they'll pass it on, then I guess that's fine. The second part, also in the same section, 38.4, the accountant must refer a judicial factor to the professional body, but that's before any potential misconduct has been determined by the court. And there was a concern that actually that doesn't seem a fair way around, that the court should decide first, and then if there is an issue having occurred, then that would then be referred on to the professional body. Is the Minister still of the view that that subsection is framed correctly? And would you like to make any comment on that?
Yes, so yeah, I think the section strikes the right balance between protecting the estate and dealing with serious misconduct. The accountant is under the duty to investigate complaints and reach a decision, and it's only right that they conclude that there has been serious misconduct and they report it to the appropriate professional body. The role of the court is to dispose of the matter as they see fit. The alternative of allowing a court to intimate would mean that time will have to be passed before the accountant finds that there has been serious misconduct and the court process begins to decide the appropriate disposal. It's only right that the professional body is notified of the matter as soon as possible to allow them time to consider the matters. And in my view, this early notice is an important safeguard for the protection of the estate and possibly other persons in case which the judicial factor acts professionally.
Yeah, so in your minds, the two are almost running side by side. So it's not that complaint would then take reference to any ongoing court case at the same point and therefore, okay, came to the same conclusion. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
No, thank you. I think certainly just in this particular area, obviously, Minister, you're very much aware we've had dialogue in the past regarding the McClure solicitors from my constituency. And I think certainly one of the main concerns from constituents and others outside of the Grimken and Brookline constituency was the fact that a judicial factor wasn't put in place. And I'm very much aware, obviously, with the other legislation that's going through Parliament at the moment, the Regulation of Legal Services. And I think in addition to this bill, I would like to think that certainly some clarity would then come forward in the future if the two bills actually do pass through the parliamentary process, obviously whether amended or not. So that if a similar situation were to arise again in the future, then it would be a clearer process for everyone to see and understand as compared to the what appears to be a sense of confusion that people who have been affected by the McClure's case has taken place.
Yes, thank you, Convener, and I know that you've taken a great interest in the situation with McClure's and you've discussed this with myself and with the Law Society. The Law Society's position on this in the public record has been given to them in the evidence session in the past couple of weeks, and I'm aware that this matter has been reported to Police Scotland, and I understand that Police Scotland have commented that an assessment on the information is ongoing. Therefore, it would be inappropriate for me to comment much further on individual circumstances of the case. In general, though, a judicial factor appointed under the Solicitors Scotland Act 1980 does not carry out any legal work in the way that an incoming firm is able to, and in many cases it may be preferable for another firm to take over the business of a failing firm rather than for a judicial factor to be appointed, provided that there are no concerns as to any misdeeds. Ultimately, the Law Society is the regulator and will be best placed to decide whether to seek the appointment of a judicial factor to a solicitor firm. But I know I'm also working very closely with yourself and other MSPs in relation to the regulation of legal services.
Okay, well, thank you, Minister. Certainly, kind of moving on, in response to the committee's call for views, the Faculty of Procurators of Caithness said it thought that there should be a specific procedure for an interested person or organisation to raise concerns about the judicial factors management of the estate. This, it proposed, would first be to the accountant, and if unsatisfied with the outcome, there would then be a role for the court. There have been suggestions from a number of witnesses that various complaints procedures already exist in practice and that the bill says all that is necessary on the subject. Does the Scottish Government think that the complaints process needs to be made clearer, either on the face of the bill or in some other way?
Thank you, Convener. Currently, if someone has a complaint against a judicial factor, then they're able to raise this either directly with the judicial factor or the accountant, and given the accountant's supervisory role. And this will continue under the bill, with the accountant being required to investigate any concerns in relation to judicial factors acting. The bill also gives the accountant a power to issue directions to the judicial factor. And further, if the accountant concludes that there has been serious misconduct or material failure, then they must refer the matter to the court to be dealt with. Most judicial factors are members of a regulated profession, and this is another way which for complaints to be heard. I know that the committee has heard from a number of stakeholders, and there doesn't seem to be any support for a new complaints procedure to be set out in the bill. But I will consider that the current approach, I do consider the current approach is practical and a sensible way at the moment to deal with complaints. I don't know, Michael, if you wanted to add anything further to that.
As the Minister has pointed out, the bill is clear that the duty is on the accountant of court to investigate any misconduct and to determine the outcome of that. I think the accountant of court and SCTS have their own web pages, and the matter could be explored with them, you know, whether they can use those web pages to set out the accounts, the accountants, the complaint procedure with the accountants. It may be that it's already up there, so it could be flagged in a better way, but you know, that's one option that we could explore it with them.
No, thank you. I mean, certainly, as has already been discussed today and in previous sessions, somebody who does become a judicial factor obviously doesn't necessarily have to be from a regulated professional course. And when we had the evidence from the missing people when they appeared before the committee last week, they felt as if that it wasn't clear from the bill what the complaints procedure is, for example, and if one family member of a missing person had concerns about how another family member was operating as a judicial factor. However, they also did feel that that setting out the complaints procedure actually would be helpful, but it didn't need to actually appear on the face of the bill. But they felt as if it actually could appear in guidance. I think certainly from their evidence, the consideration would be that not every judicial factor, if it involved a missing person, it would be from a regulated profession. It could potentially could be like a family member. So in terms of their concerns with regards to the guidance, is that something that we consider?
No.
Okay, yep. Thank you. Thanks. And Faisal Chowdhury.
Thank you. Minister, you'll be glad to know I think it's the last question. So the Law Society has highlighted to the committee that it would like additional powers to those provided in the Solicitors Scotland Act 1980 to deal with certain issues that can arise with firms taking the form of incorporated practice. When the Law Society gave evidence to the committee on 23rd April, it indicated that its preferred legislative vehicle for change was Stage 2 amendments to the Regulation of Legal Services Scotland Bill. Can the committee check that the Scottish Government is currently of the view that the Legal Services Bill is the right place to add the powers the Law Society is seeking?
Yes. At the Regulation of Legal Services Bill team are working on amendments with the Law Society and other MSPs that will address this concern. So I'm comfortable that the Regulation of Legal Services will address that specific issue.
Thank you.
Thank you. Do colleagues have any further questions? Tim Eagle.
Can I just ask one quick general question that sort of came into my mind as various of the witnesses had spoken, and that was around pretty much all of them welcomed actually the update to this bill. I think one made reference to a couple of paragraphs in a Victorian bill where the old judicial factors were. But then I was going back and looking in the previous notes, and the Scottish Law Commission first published a discussion paper on this in 2010, full recommendations from them in 2013. We're obviously now in 2024. And it was just around that, like, is that normal for law reform to take that long? Is there an issue there, or is there something we can do to sort of speed up law reform in Scotland more generally?
I'll bring in Michael, but just from my experience as a minister for a year, the trust and succession one that went through last year, it was the same time scale, like 10 years ago they had done it. So I think there's a bit of a challenge with legislation and parliamentary timetable of where we can slot in this legislation. But I think we've taken through 8 SLC bills, and I think we are determined to keep progressing with them as we go in. But I don't know, Michael, you want to raise, because you've got a lot of history.
There's a number of reports from the SLC that we're looking to take forward, and we're giving consideration to this session. The judicial factors is obviously from 2013, but you know, we're starting to get through those reports. This is the third SLC bill that we brought through this year. I think it's 8 over the last 10 years or so. The Parliament, this committee, have done a lot of work in amending Parliament's standing orders, or work on the Parliament standing orders for the SLC bills. So it means that bills like the judicial factors can be taken through by this committee rather than a normal subject committee. So that does allow us scope and time in the legislative programme to deal with the Scottish Law Commission reports. We are getting through the backlog. There are obviously a couple of other reports that were considered in this session. I think the Minister wrote to Lady Payton, the Chair of the Scottish Law Commission, in September, I think it was last year, to talk about how we're giving consideration to reports on aspects of leases and contract. So, you know, there's 3 bills this session. There's a couple of years still left of this one. And, you know, we're working our way through. I should say that the judicial factors is probably the oldest one that I think we have or that we're considering. Trust, I think, was 2014, so that was also old. But, you know, once we start to get through, I think contract was 2018, so we're taking a leap forward with those ones. Obviously, they're still a bit dated, but, you know, we are committed to implementing the reforms, and, yeah, we're working our way through them.
Perfect. No, thank you. I was just curious. I thought, law maybe is not always that fast, but I wondered if there was a hold up, because obviously there's probably quite a lot that, as you've mentioned, that will want to come through the system, and if they all take 10 years, it's quite a long time. But no, if it's just about parliamentary time and space, and I suppose best use of this committee, then, isn't it, as to how we can push these things forward? Thank you very much for that.
Can I just say one thing? We recently hosted. Well, Lady Payton came because she had people from all over the UK and was showing them around the Parliament, and they were really impressed from this that we had this committee that enabled scrutiny on the proposals that they put forward. So, yeah, it's very positive.
I think certainly just, I'm sure I can speak for all colleagues, because it's an issue that's come up certainly in the past. And Mr. Eagle's a new member to the Office of the Parliament and also to the committee. But certainly, I mean, this committee is always happy to oblige when it comes to SLC reports and legislation, because I think that the work that we have undertaken, certainly in this session but also in the previous session, I think it shows that the valuable work of this committee and certainly the level of scrutiny that we do place upon the legislation. So we're always happy to have more. Any further questions from colleagues? No. Minister, is there anything else you'd like to add?
No, thank you.
No, okay, thank you. So can I thank the Minister and her officials for their evidence this morning, and the committee may follow up by letter with any additional questions stemming from the meeting. And so with that, this now concludes the public part of the meeting. And once again, thank you very much, and I move the committee into private.